Appreciate this paper with the trilogy on it, so I can put my throat thing, place to rest it. God rest its soul. Sweet and salty nut. What are you trying to say? What are you trying to say here? That's my man right there. All right. Let's begin 1 John chapter 3. And we're going to look at a couple of verses in light of sonship and the Father and that place. The first ones we've sort of hit on before. This time we'll go to also some other verses, two other verses in chapter 4. But 1 John chapter 3, and what we're trying to discover, let's see. Fill in the blank. I'm going to seek the Lord for his blank every day. What? Heart. You know, I just want to tell you that y'all are not normal in Christianity. Most people would say, I'm going to seek his will. Wouldn't they? Think about it. Then think about the people you know. I'm going to seek his will. But his will is to seek his face. You know? And that's true of the bride toward Christ, and that's true of sons to be conformed to the image of him, because when we look, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, I don't remember which verse, 5 maybe, or 4, and it says that the light of the knowledge of the glory of God is in the face of Jesus. So to look into his face is to see the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And this was a big deal to Jesus. It was a big deal to Jesus because he was so much about fulfilling the desire of the Father. And so you could say it like this. You could say it. He was so desirous to fulfill the will of God, or the will of the Father. But in Christianity, and that's not across the board, but in some, there is this thought of, well, I want to do the will of God. I want to do the will of God. I want to do the will of God. I want to be in the will of God. I want to find the will of God. I want to, you know. And it's that, I mean, even the terminology there in a certain sense is not really recognizing that Jesus has a desire in his heart we call the will of God for a bride, or the Father has a desire in his heart for sons in the image of Christ. But we, even if we know that and we just resort to the terminology of, well, I want to do the will of God for Jesus, or I want to do the will of God for the Father, it is still comes short of a true intimacy and heart desire to please him with what satisfies him. Does that make sense? And so and here's my point is that if we use that terminology enough, we can literally move out and separate from the actual intimacy of the whole satisfaction of his heart and just set about to do the Christian thing for God. Let's just do the Christian thing. No, let's don't. I say let's don't. And it's this kind of stuff why I'm in trouble. Mallard claps and does this for the right reason. Yeah, and it is because the point is, let's not just do the will of God. Let's satisfy the heart of the Father with His Son within us, formed within us. Which, I mean, to say it like that implies that you are familiar with His heart and not just some terminology, let's do the will of God. And it also implies that you care, which is, yeah, that's something strange in Christian, that you care about the Father or you care about Jesus. Our whole deal is that they care about us. That's our whole deal. That's Christianity in a nutshell. That God cares about us and He will take care of da 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 and all those kind of things. But we've lost the give and take. We've lost the I and you and me. We've lost the flow of the Godhead that we've been brought into. We've lost the flow of life. It's their life. The flow of the Godhead is the flow of how they live. It's their life and the way they live. So there is a disconnect sometimes in our terminology, or sometimes our terminology shows that there is a disconnect with the things that are important to Him. It's almost like if you're sitting there talking about somebody and they're right there, but you're just talking about them, you know, in a godly way, but you're not acknowledging them or their heart or their influence in the conversation or in the flow of what you're talking about. It is, you know, it's like we know there's a God, and we resort to Him, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We resort when our need arises, a crisis arises, our need or something we want that satisfies us, you know, or, but in the relationship that is meant to be, and particularly in this relationship with the Father and the Son that we've entered into, this fellowship, that's a flow with them, where they're at. You know, we're always trying to get Him to fellowship in our stuff. But what we've entered into is a give and take of, you know, Jesus is praying. One of His last prayers before He goes into the garden and before He goes to the cross is, Father, that they may be one as we are one. Well, that's an eternal one. And He describes it, I and you and me. So the Father's wanting the Son in us so that we function by His nature and we give back the Son, or we manifest sonship. We give back the Son to the Father, or we manifest sonship. Both are the same, but more intimately, we would say that we give the Father what He desires, which is His Son. That's a worthy goal. That's a worthy goal if our hearts are in the right place. So anyway, that little fill in the blanks came to my mind. I was singing a song and it actually had the words, seek the Lord for His face every day instead of for His will every day. But I thought, oh my God, usually we don't put that in there. All right, so we are in 1 John chapter 3. We're going to read verse 1 through 3. And I'm going to read this according to the Scofield Bible. I think so. Behold what manner of love the Father, okay, so we know Jesus loves us because he died for us, right? So why does the Father love us? Well, you know, yeah, he's just God and God loves, so that's, you know, that's it. But what if that was a more intimate thing tied to something he longed after before the foundation of the world? What if it was that? And I think these scriptures are going to bear that out. I think they're going to bear it out. Okay? Behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God. And that is the actual word there. And we'll get into that eventually, Lord willing, where there's two different Greek words used. One is huios and one is technon or technon or technology on, I don't know. And that's what you are if you're a child. You're a robot, technon. That we should be, now notice this, behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. Okay, so this is when that takes place, there's a, you know, here we are as children of God. So there's the God side. And the world side. And then there's also our side, so I'm going to just draw that this way. I make these charts up as I go. So behold, look at the love, and here we definitely, because of this scripture, is trying to enlighten us. It is trying to bring us into the intimacy of the heart of the Father. And it is trying to bring us, into the will of the Father. Or better said, it is trying to bring us in to that thing which will bring satisfaction to the Father for which he created all things. Okay. A child, you remember the scripture in Isaiah that says, behold, a child is born. What is it? I know I was going to say it. But thank you, because I am an idiot and I do need help. Okay, so a child is born. That's pretty much all it can do. But a son is given. A son is given. And the son is given. And we in our child state, we are by the very nature of being a child of God, we're on a journey. By the very nature of any child born, they have just begun a journey. Right? It's built into it. You don't even have to try. Because time will, if nothing else. And you know, I know people that are, you know, like 40, 50 years old, and they still act like a child. I know guys that still like video games all the time. That's what they want to do, you know. That's all right. I mean, I hope they, like, hold the highest numbers on some games and stuff, because you got to have some reason for living. Anyway. A child is born. Behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God. But what is the manner of love? Okay? Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. From the world side, we are now different. Okay, what's the definition of different? Okay, because, you know, I mean, see, I'm always having to go between God's view, Jesus' view, the Father's view, and the world or Christianity's view. So we are different. What is the difference? Well, let's see. If I look at my life, I don't deal drugs anymore, and I don't go hang out at bars or... I can't tell you where I hung out. Because if I did, you would disrespect me. Just kidding. So we say that's the change. That's the change. That's, you know, I don't smoke anymore. I don't, you know, do all this. I'm so much a better person. You know, now that's a child's view of what happened to you. All right? What is the change? The change is... you didn't just get saved from hell. You didn't just get redeemed from punishment. You didn't get just redeemed from the consequences of your actions. You got redeemed unto God. And you got Christ in you. You didn't just get redeemed from, you got redeemed unto, and you got Christ in you, the Son of God. He put, that's part of the deal. Because that's the change. Now you're one with him. You're not just saved. You're not just Christian. Can you see that? I mean, it would be like a little baby is born and it comes out and goes, I'm a Christian. Yeah. No, you're not. You're born with new life. And I'm really not trying to put down Christianity as much as I'm trying to lift the Lord out of a lot of concepts called Christianity that bury the Lord and won't let him be raised out of it and don't want to talk about him within it. It's us, and I'm a Christian, and I'm committed, and I'm this, and I'm, you know, all of the things that we're not except by Christ, at least in the Father's eyes, and that's the only one that counts. All right. So, the world doesn't know you. The world doesn't know you. I don't even know you anymore. You know? Why? Well, you're different. Let me tell you. It's not just that your friends, when you got saved, they looked at you and went, you don't go, you know, you're going to church instead of, you know, your big day is Sunday, not Friday night. Or Saturday. No, it doesn't matter how drastically you've changed outwardly. They don't know you anymore because they're darkness and you're light in the Lord. And they may not understand why they react against you. They may not understand why they don't. They just know deep within their being, not within their mind, I don't know this. This is unfamiliar territory. So the world doesn't know us because of Christ who is in us, but there has to be the journey, or we're just going to be a Christian, a child, the rest of our lives. And we'll be that for God, but it won't satisfy his heart because he wants sons in the image of Christ. All right, so let's see if this goes there. Okay. All right. Verse 2, beloved, right now, we are the children of God. When you get saved, that's what you are. You're a child of God. Right now are we the children of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Okay, so there's a shall be, and there's an appearing. And there's a future, and there's a journey, and there's a glorious end for the Father, not just for us. A glorious. And we read that in Hebrews 2, and it's just precious. I don't know how many of you ever went back and or got the CD or whatever and listened to it. But we got into that part where it talks about what we do see and what God the Father wanted to get out of it and what the glorious end of Jesus' death was really about toward the Father. Beloved, now are we the children of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Now, he says, now you are born into this family, but what you shall be has not yet appeared. But we know that when, we know that when we grow up and mature, we'll be special sons of God. That's what it says, isn't it? No. It says when he appears. This is talking about what we shall be. Come on, that's the word of God there. I didn't come in your Bible and write something different overnight. That's what it says. And it's always said that. And of course we make that, well, when he appears in the sky, we'll be what he wants. Really? Really? It sounds to me like then all we're going to be is we're a child of God, and when he appears in the sky, we'll be child babies, sky babies. We'll be sky babies. You know? Oh, my Jesus, my daddy. You know? And we're still this thing here because what we're looking for the change is someday far away, which has never happened for anybody for 2,000 years. Are they still waiting for his appearing? Are they? Is anyone who is born again in purgatory or whatever? No. No. So this is talking about a change from, and this is talking about a change from being a child to a son, and this is talking about a fulfillment for the heart of the Father. Gosh, a fulfillment for the heart of the Father. Do we see it? Do we normally read this and go, woo-hoo, the Father's going to get what he's designed? Or do we go, well, Jesus is going to catch me up in there, and I'm going to be changed, and everybody's going to be happy at that day, so in the meantime, I'll just act like a hell baby. But I'll be a sky baby. And it's going to be a biggie. It's going to be Christianity's biggest thing. Y'all don't tell anybody I talk like this, okay? Yeah, it's all over the internet. Okay. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Oh, my God, that's so full. There is a plethora of reality in that little bit right there. What we shall be doesn't appear, but when he appears, what we shall be hasn't appeared yet, but when he appears, I need to shut this thing down. Cassie's sending me, because she's probably on there right now messing with me. She is not. Okay. I was telling Deb today, the only time I put my phone on airplane mode is when I'm not on an airplane. And I'm on airplanes a lot. Okay. And you're going, I don't want to ride with you because you're going to bring that plane down. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, don't worry. It might be at the very time he comes back and we'll be sky babies. Kelly wrote a song called Sky Babies. From hell baby to sky baby. Does not yet appear. Yeah. And if you get left behind, you'll be a crybaby. And so it goes. Sorry. You know, I can't control this any more than you can. I have absolutely no control over this stuff. Okay. It does not yet appear, but when he appears, okay, so when he appears, this is the fulfillment in this way. When he appears, we shall be, and we know this, when he shall appear, we shall be like him. All right, so that step is that if this top one up here were the sun, then we are changed from children to in son. Have we already discussed that so far? Hebrews chapter 1. In son, and therefore sons of God. Because this is the what I've referred to many years ago in teaching tabernacle. This is the pomegranate son. Many seeds within the seed. Yeah. Are you familiar with pomegranates? Okay. And I'm not talking about pomegranate juice that is
healthy
and organic. Organical. I love organical. I love saying that to people that are like really into organic. And I say, oh, is that organical? This drives them nuts. You're an idiot. That's what they think. And I don't mind because... because I think they're one. No, sorry. All right, this thing's going downhill fast. But we know that. Here's something that we're supposed to know. But we know that, do we? Do we know that when he shall appear, we're going to be like him? All right. So I'm not even trying to, quote unquote, put down the rapture or whatever. I'm trying to say that if the being like him is when he appears in the air someday, then nobody's like him yet. Well, then you're all bound for hell. Y'all are. Because I know this. Sorry. We're just joking, Skype people. We're just weird. Sky baby, cry baby, all that stuff. That's when he shall appear, we shall be like him. Why? For we shall see him in the sky. No. For we shall see him as he is. And folks, that's the problem with the church, is it not? That we haven't seen him as he is and become conformed to the image of his, the Father's, Son. We haven't. We haven't done this. We haven't realized, if we don't know this, I'm saying on the ground of, if we don't know this, then we're waiting for something that hadn't happened for any generation, but it's going to happen in mine. Well, it might, but what if it doesn't? Then that scripture is worthless. Let's, everybody, rip it out of your Bible right now. It doesn't apply. Attaboy. Yeah. Because if we, if we ripped everything out of our Bible that people said didn't apply, we would only have a few sheets in there. But at least they'd be organical. Okay. For we shall see him as he is. Okay. Now this is important, and we're not going to get into this probably tonight, but I want to, if you don't get anything else out of this first session, I want you to consider this, which you probably won't. Well, you will. No, you will. I know that you will remember Hell Baby and Cry Baby. So. Yeah, Sky Baby. And yeah. So anyway, y'all are getting me off track here. It was important too. And it would have changed your life. But now, here's where you are and here's where you will be. No, this, we shall see him as he is. I personally am convinced, and that doesn't matter, but I am convinced that many Christians only know him as they perceive him based on their need, wants, and desires. Now, I'm going to get into that eventually. But that I think that's a powerful reality. And let's put it this way. When we get, and we might do it soon, when we get into John 6, we're going to see that that was the problem, that they could not comprehend something that they did not know, because not knowing him as he is, they're not changed into that same image. They comprehended Jesus in a glorious Jewish context, but they didn't know him as he is. And that's important. All right. So, verse 3, and every man that hath this hope, what hope? Of changing from being a child to a son of God by Christ, by the Son, having this hope where? In him, not just in his brain, but in reality, has grasped the knowing part of this. But we know that purifieth himself even as he is pure. And here's the purification. You want to see it? Here's the purification. The transition from child to son. There's the purification. That's the context. That's the purification. Okay. Does that sound like Christian purification? Or Jewish purification? No, it is, again, that's, you know, all I'm saying is we just need to see him as he is. That's the purification. And then the transition begins to happen. It doesn't appear, but when he appears, the purification begins. And we begin to be conformed to the Son that is everything the Father wanted, except he wants more of him in us by his spirit and nature. You still have your personality. You still are you in every sense of the word, except for your old nature is no longer the thing that you live by. Live by, not just recognize concepts and can spot them under many religious situations, but live with him in this reality. I in you and you in me. I mean, those are great words, folks, but doggone how many of us really, you know, are there? And how many of us, because we think we know it, how many of us pursue that reality on a living basis? Amen. You know? I mean, that was Jesus' prayer, his last prayer. It was his prayer request, and he's asking, you know, he's wanting us to help that would get fulfilled. Hallelujah. You know, he answers our prayers. Why can't we just answer one of his? Yes. You know? Even as he is pure. Even as he is. Even as he is. Not even as he does. To purify us. The purification is even as he is. And that is going to take us seeing him as he is. And to see him as he is going to have to take an abandonment of all of our ways that we have comprehended him as a child. Because there's only one comprehension here. I'm in the Son is in me. And this is toward the Father. The heart of the Son is towards the Father, and the heart of the sons are towards the Father. Okay? Come out. I knew somebody would get deliverance tonight. But down here, there are a multiplicity of all sorts of ways of knowing Jesus. You know, we're going to get him in this way, and we're gonna see him, and he's going to do this, and he's going to do that. And all of those ways are not really knowing him. Those ways are usually in relationship to knowing what he can do for us. Which misses the desire of the heart of the Father from the foundation of the world. And it also keeps us being a child. It keeps us in babyhood. You agree with that, Jim? I'll drink to that. All right. Let's go to some other verses now. Let's go to chapter 4 and verse 9 and 10. Okay. Now, as we read, Try to listen to the Holy Spirit, but also as we read, attune your heart towards the satisfaction or the desire of the Father so that our eyes might see that kind of stuff in here. All right? Verse 9, chapter 4, 1 John. In this was manifest the love of God toward us. In this was manifest the love of God toward us because that God sent his only begotten Son. Okay, so when it says God there, don't just read God. I mean, I know that it's okay to do that in other places. It's not okay here in the sense that he sent his only begotten Son. It's Father. Look at it. This is the work of the Father. All right, so this isn't just the work of the Savior. Because it's not talking about you. Not yet. But it's talking about the eternal plan or the desire of the Father's heart. In this was manifest the love of God toward us because that God, or the Father, sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. It didn't say that you'd get saved. It didn't say you wouldn't go to hell. It didn't say all that kind of stuff. And it says that in other places. That's fine, but this is not that. And I'll give you a little secret. The Gospel of John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, particularly those books, are about the Father and the Son coming to fulfill what was in the heart of the Father. So if you read this here, if I said, look up every reference to the Father in those books, you would get your Strong's Concordance or one of these things, and you would type in Father, wouldn't you? And you'd say, there, here's my homework. I did it. But you would have missed this one, wouldn't you? And how many more would you have missed? Or how many times would you miss the Father-Son relationship in order to bring sons to him? How many times? As many times as we read it, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. And we'll see him as the Son of the Father and also the bearer or the bringer of many sons through his death to the Father, to the glory of the Father. All right, so if I made that your homework, it would not be easy now, would it? It wouldn't be easy now because it would require you to actually read the Bible instead of look something up. And you go, well, here's the list, and 1, 2, 3, 4. See, it would. You could actually give your homework and get extra credit because you did the homework and miss the heart of the Father. In this was manifested the love of God, the Father, toward us, because that God sent, the Father sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. That not just that we might live, another Christian concept, that we just might live, that we might live, that we were, going to go to hell, but now we're going to live, we're going to live for eternity. And I've said it before, but I remember when I was a new Christian and somebody said, praise God, but now that we're saved, we're going to live for, forever. And I said, so's everybody else. The ones in hell, they're going to live forever too. Nobody ceases. They just live in another place. This is not that. This is not, I get to live forever. This is, we get to live by Christ the Son to the Father, and the Father is going to be joyous over it. I mean, if you could picture it, we always picture these things of heaven or whatever. If you could picture, I'm walking through the pearly gates, and the Father is standing there going, come to me, my sons. Come to me. And we go, what's this, some sort of greeting? What's this special greeting when we come in through the door? Instead of, yes, this is it, and you get it, And that's just a picture. I'm just, We miss something precious that we could have given. We could have given. Y'all say that with me. We could have given. But we didn't, and we don't. Because, and I'm not being mean here or whatever, but we could have given, but we don't, because we're takers. We're takers. I know that every one of us have had times when we worship the Lord and honored him, but I also know many times worship felt good and we did it for us. I mean, it's just true. We all know we have. I don't know the percentage, but God does. But whatever the percentage is, he loses. All right, so in this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Okay, so let's look at that. I'm going to give this a little bit different twist here, and you listen carefully to see if a certain portion of this isn't true. All right, this is... my translation, which means nothing because I'm not a Greek scholar. I shouldn't be doing stuff like this, except for Greek scholars will never know the heart of God unless they are pursuing the heart of God instead of the Greek. Here is how we are meant to comprehend that God loves us, but in this is manifested the love of God toward us, okay? Here is how we are meant to comprehend that God loves us. He sent his Son to us that we might live by the Son. And even further, here is the definition of love, not that we have warm feelings of deep gratitude towards God for saving us, for love is only defined within the realm of a selfless death carried out by the Son for us. Not that we loved him, because that love, in most part, until it has embraced the cross as its reality, that love that we give back, he doesn't count as love, because in most part, it's not out of Son, therefore totally selfless in its giving. It's got agendas. It's got aces up its sleeve. It's got, you know, what do I get out of this? You ever heard somebody say that? What do I get out of this? Can you imagine saying that to the Father? God. You know, well, what do I get out of this? He'd go, well, never mind. I'm not going to speak for the Father. Okay. So, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to... Okay, so he's sending his Son, and yes, he is the propitiation for our sins, because behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God, because the propitiation for our sins and calling us children of God is the first step to find out what we shall be, sons. I hope this is clear. Yeah. This is a process. This is a journey. So anytime it mentions, I can't say that. Let me just say it like this. Many times in scriptures, I find it a lot in John's writings, when he mentions what we would call salvation, it's always an ongoing thing to enter into something higher. Sonship, the love of God, da-da-da-da. And in this scripture, it's almost rebuking us, saying it's not because... Okay. If the Father wants sons, or if Jesus wants a bride, do you think that he'd like something in return? Yes. Yes. Do you think maybe one of the biggest things would be love? Yes. Okay. All right. Well, but what did this just say? Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. So is this telling us? I mean, let's be honest. Is this telling us that he doesn't want our love? Or he doesn't want love? He just wants to love. Okay? Well, okay. No, it's not. It's telling us that until we have entered into this realm where it is all out from the Son, then he's not getting Son love. He might get it from the Son, but he's not getting it from the sons. Okay. But in this state as a child, he doesn't want it. He doesn't want our love because it's not, how did I put this? Here is the definition of love. Not that we have warm feelings or deep gratitude toward God for saving us, for love is only defined within the realm of a selfless death carried out by the Son for us. That's here. That's what it's talking about here. But once that love or that Son or the Son of his kind of love is seen and known as he is toward the Father and not just toward us, then we are able to manifest that love also. Did you have a thought or something?
What you're saying is that the love in the Godhead, or love that is the Godhead, it manifests by giving its most precious thing, its own life. And to us, love is, we'll never give ourselves, except for the Lamb of God be in us. We'll never give ourselves in that way. we'll give, but we will never give in the way the Lamb of God or the Father gave His Son. And so, I know it's like John's pointing at holding something so much higher than any child could ever manifest apart from the. You say the Lamb is the way the Father gave His Son, it's the way the Lamb gave Himself, it's the way the Spirit. The way they give, or the way they love, is utter, complete to death.
Right.
The best. It's. He's like, this is love. Hello. Behold, God, Father, Son. You're not that.
Not as a child.
Not as a child.
But as a son or one who knows this and see, and then his appearing, they see him as he is, then that kind of love, he wants that. He exalted the love of Jesus on the cross to the highest degree.
Hallelujah.
But you know, we go, well, you know, and that's why I put in here, we're not talking about, not that we have warm feelings and deep gratitude toward God for saving us, but more like love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth. Wow, we can't even get past those two. I mean, you know, come on. We can't even get past that. We are petty. Did you know that? How many of you know that? Raise your hand. How many of you just raised your hand but have no clue about that? Okay. Love suffereth long. Well, there were three things there. Love suffereth long. Love suffers long. You know, I mean, we go, you know, we get into a little suffering and stuff, and we go, this is too much, you know. Give me a way of escape. And I'm convinced, and you don't have to be convinced of this, that he says he will not put on you more than you can bear, but will give a way of escape. And I believe the way of escape out of that crybaby, no fly baby attitude is the cross. That's the way of escape out of all of that selfish fleshly stuff that can't handle this and can't do that. Well, you need to die and you'll learn to suffer long. You know, I mean, you are dead. You're dead with Christ. That's finished. But I'm saying that needs to be applied to such a degree that you are now one with Him and you can suffer long. You'll do it gloriously and gladly. Nah, I'm not saying, you know, it'd be like if somebody's up here just pinching the heck out of me in somewhere or whatever. I wouldn't, you know, I might be able to go for a long time with it, but I might be bruised and go, wow, you know, that hurt. Well, love hurts. Haven't you ever heard that song from the 80s? All right, well, we're not using the 80s as our measure of Jesus, okay? But love suffereth long and is kind. Is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself, meaning puffs up itself or lifts itself up or puts itself forward. Is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not its own. Wow. I mean, that right there nails everybody. Well, it does. It nails everybody except Jesus. It's going to take the nature of Jesus. See, He sent His Son that we might live by Him. Hello, this is what He meant, you know. Is not easily provoked. And see, here's us. Well, I'm not easily provoked. And I'm offended that you said that. I think maybe you are. I think it's worse than what you think. And besides, if we're not easily provoked or we suffer long, here's how long we suffer, and here's how long we're not easily provoked. And His measure is way different than our measure. His measure is the Son, remember? The measuring, and to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, not our measure, and we're always using our measure to measure ourselves and measure others. We go, well, I suffer longer than you. I'm holy. Yeah, you are. You're holy. You're leaking all over the place. Thinketh no evil. Thinketh no evil. I mean, it doesn't say thinketh no evil thing to do to somebody. It's just saying thinking thoughts that are not the Lord. It's called our thoughts. Our ways are not his ways. We think evil, he doesn't. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never fails. All right, so what is love? God is love, right? All right, so here's the Son, here's the Father, and when you enfold them with the Holy Spirit, you have love, because love cannot exist by itself. Love has to have someone else to prove, to manifest that it is true love. We're talking about God here. It is true. And so it is proven between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit constantly. There is this, I seek not my own, I seek your glory. I seek, you know, this is the way the Godhead works. This is what love is. And so here is the definition of love. Not that we have warm feelings or deep gratitude toward God for saving us, for love is only defined within the realm of a selfless death carried out by the Son for us, and then ultimately in us. For us, the child, to bring us into him, so that this love, and this is that's 1 John. Did you know? I mean, if you read on, it's going to just lay it out there, you know, about love. And he'll just say, look, you don't, you know, if this isn't working in you, it's not love. And here's the deal. See, this isn't just an issue of love, but it is in the sense that the Father will never get the kind of love he wants. Jesus will never get the kind of love he wants. It's not going to happen. But it's first and foremost, because love is a nature. It's the nature of God at work within us. It's first and foremost being brought in, seeing him as he is, and here's how he is towards the Father. When he came, and we're going to see all that eventually here. Love is only defined within the realm of a selfless death. Not that we loved. Oh, I love you for dying for me. Okay, well, you did your part, Jesus. But we can't call anything we have toward him as true agape love until it's the Son. All right? All right. Let's stop. Take a break.